Assalamu alaikum, Aki.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, son of Malcolm.
And how are you, sir? El Hajj.
Alhamdulillah. All praises due to Allah, man. All praises due to Allah.
Alhamdulillah, of Allah, let me preach it to Allah, Subhanahu wa Rahim, which is we send blessings on Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and on the holy
Ahlul Bayt wa salam.
Yaki, what are we chopping up today? So much going on in the world at this moment. The George Floyd thing is kicking off. Who's that black brother that's in the Star Wars? What do we call his name?
I can't remember the brother, but he's a Peckham youth still. Real, one of the real ones, because he said what he had to say and he won't really respond. So I kind of appreciate his boldness, you know what I mean?
Alhamdulillah. So we're chopping up today, bro, because obviously...
Yeah, a sister...
Got the pale... the non-black Muslim brothers and sisters who are trying to supposed to support the Black Lives Matter movement or the horrendous brutality and murder and brutalization by those racist, fascist police force in America and the killing of George Floyd. But it seems to be mixed up with other aspects of almost denying the racism in the Muslim community, not in Islam, in the Muslim community. And you wanted to kind of touch on that.
Yeah, well, a sister dropped a video and kind of like was saying, well, you know, that non-black Muslims really kind of be considerate in terms of getting involved and trying to direct the narrative in terms of, you know what I mean, black people's liberation struggle against white racism, white supremacy. And I think she had some really interesting words. Maybe just I'd appreciate if we could just hear a few of her words and then we can kind of like explore that and get your analysis. I would appreciate that, my brother.
Alhamdulillah. For those who don't know, the picture is of the sister. It's not actually me protecting myself from the Chinese flu or how I dress up in my spare time. So if you see the picture on the screen, it's her. Right, let's go for it.
That's your issue. That's your issue. But what you're not going to do is jump onto our feeds and jump onto our lives and jump into our DMs, centering yourself and your experience of life as a Muslim and even Islam in this conversation. Because this, my dear friends, is not a conversation about Islam. It's not a conversation about Islam and Islam's stance on racism or Islam's stance on black people or anything. So please do not quote any hadith. Do not bring any ayat of Quran, and please leave Bilal radiallahu anhu's name out of your mouth. Do not fix your mouth to bring Bilal radiallahu anhu into this conversation. He is free from it. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is free from it. We are not talking.
Alhamdulillah, that's it, sister.
That's your
issue.
Well,
go for it.
How are you, that sister?
Alhamdulillah.
That's your issue.
That's your issue. So what say you about that, bro? What say you about that? You think the sister went in too hard, or you think the sister didn't go in hard enough? Or did she nail it? Did she kind of name the elephant in the room when it comes to anti-black racism? Because I think what she said that was so fascinating, really, really want to get your thoughts on it, is about centering yourself. Something about always being the leader of black people, whether they're Muslim or non-Muslim. So this issue with George Floyd erupts. Black people, Muslim and non-Muslim alike, are hurt by it, as well as other people, to be fair. However, some Muslims, non-black Muslims, just feel the automatic triggering to center themselves in the narrative, to jump on people's DMs, jump in people's DMs, on their feeds, whatever it is, and get kind of involved, not in a supportive way, in a humble way, how can we support you, we feel your pain, but more in a way of directing and quoting, and you know the hagiographers, hailing the greats, quoting the Quran, quoting the Prophet, quoting the ulama of old about racist attitudes or Islam stance on racism. So kind of usurping the dialogue. What say you?
I totally agree with what the sister is saying. I think this is long overdue. I think that this anti-black racism within the so-called Muslim community is something in all the years I've been a Muslim, I've experienced. We've been...
How long is that? How long is that, brother? How long have you been a Muslim?
This is by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? So we've been knocking on the door of the masjids. We've been going to all of the majlises, and we've been going to all of the circles, and we've been saying to these communities, the Pakistani community, the Iranian community, the Arab community, the Bengali community, that we are fear-facing evident racism. Once somebody takes shahada, you're welcome into the deen, but when you're welcome into the deen, it's under their views on things, and they make you feel less welcome. So they hold up Bilal radiallahu anhu as if somehow the Prophet chose him because he was black. Prophet didn't choose him or any of his companions based on their color or based on their ethnicity. He chose the most righteous, the most sincere, and the most committed individuals, and they took those positions. The idea that some Prophet went around picking people like he picked licorice all sorts because he liked this particular term, that particular color, is nonsense. And the idea that, as you said, like, somehow Bilal Rajulat Anham was different to an Arab because of his color is nonsense. Again, because he was called Bilal Ibn Rabah. That means his mother was Ethiopian, but his father was Arab. And you go by the kunya, your father. So he was an Arab by all intents and purposes, not through his mother. So we can see that the idea that somehow he was this black guy amongst all these white-looking Arabs is a nonsense. And this narrative that the so-called Muslim Ummah in this country are using to point the finger at American racism, pointing the finger at American brutality as if somehow the non-Muslims haven't solved this problem, but we solved the problem, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yeah, he did solve it maybe 1400 years ago, but you haven't solved it now. You haven't solved it.
It's been unsolved. Can I say that it's been unsolved since it was rectified by the Prophet and he laid a template down? Yeah. Right, it would appear the time that we live in, if you go by your experiences, if I over 20 odd years, 30 years, if I go by my experiences over 20 odd years, nearly 30 years, and countless brothers and sisters from the Caribbean, from the Americas, from Great Britain, who you speak to, when you talked about interacting in Muslim communities of people from the Middle East and Asia and traditional Muslim societies that have immigrated into England, America, Canada. The racism, the anti-black prejudice, yeah, is overwhelming, it's thick, it's the elephant in the room. We've been cracking on about this for such a long time. We've been breaking this down, chopping this up for years, literally decades. But it's somehow now in vogue, bro. It's now in vogue.
Correct, and this is the point. I think what it is, again, this is to shield the gutter, filthy practices of these communities who in themselves are endemic with tribalism, endemic with ethnocentrism, endemic with disparities between between different communities within their own community. So this is why we have different mosques in each corner. We have a Pakistani mosque, and then you're gonna have a Turkish mosque, and then you're gonna have a Bangladeshi mosque, and in each mosque you might have a Diabundi or you might have a Brelvi. You know what I mean? So you have different sects, and then amongst them in their tribes, the lighter skin Pakistani might not go with a darker skin Pakistani. So they've got these riddled with these prejudices, and when we come Muslim, it's easy for them to kind of collectively get together and point the finger at us. But the point is, they're trying to take away our voice. So when we say Black Lives Matter, oh brother, do not talk about this in Islam. There is no color, blah blah blah. So they're doing the same thing when people say All Lives Matter. It's the same thing.
That they are not only just trying to stifle the debate, yeah, but I want to know about the origins. Let's think about it on a psychological level, yeah? Not necessarily psychoanalytic, but let's psychotherapeutic level, right? Is there a fear of a black planet, and does that extend to the Ummah? You know, do people see, right, non-black people in the Muslim Ummah, do many of them, not all, but many of them, see our rise as their demise?
I would say so, because you have to understand one thing. When Queen Isabella and Ferdinand of Castile and Aragon conquered the Moors in Grenada in 1492, one thing she said was, she said, we can never ever have it ever known in the history books that these black men from West Africa, these black Moors, these Negroes, these Africoids came and conquered us for nearly 900 years. So she said, destroy all the books, burn the evidence. And it's interesting that in 1492, the fall of Muslim Spain, black Muslim Spain, led to the rise of slavery in the Caribbean and in Africa and in the Americas.
Okay, the transatlantic slave trade, yeah?
Slave trade. And Huey P. Newton made a good point. He said, if you breed human beings for 400 years and the weak ones die off, and if you go by evolutionary biology, then only the strongest will survive. So you breed a people, you've actually bred a people who are superior, and it, not because superior is in there better, but they will survive more. And we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that he created man from black mud. Kalakal insan hameen. Black mud ultimately shape. So he created man. So everybody comes from that black mud that Allah used.
From the original man.
Original man. So there is this fear of a black planet. So this is why...
When we say, oh, sorry, can I just quote something, brother? When we say original man, we literally mean the original human being, Adam, as the Afrikoid genetic makeup of a black person. We don't mean regional man like no Asiatic black man or anything to do with any doctrine of that nature. I don't want people to get it twisted, yeah?
That we are the mother and father of all humanity. And what we mean is that Prophet, we know historically, was a black man. Forget the dodgy hadith. The stronger hadith prove he was a dark-skinned man. Now, may not dark-skinned, he may not be like George Floyd's complexion, but he would have been called brown complexion. He still would have been African. Like maybe something like Bob Marley's not necessarily the same as Shabba Ranks in complexion. They're both human and they're both black. So Bilal may have been the same color as Shabba Ranks, or Ali could have been darker than Bilal, because according to somebody, he was the other man. He was actually black, black intense, which is darker than Adam, the color of Adam. So what I'm saying is that there is a fear. And I think what it is, again, it goes to this fact that people, the Asians feel, if we marry our daughters to these black men, we're going to lose our ethnicity, lose our lineage, because the black gene will dominate. And we don't want to have this loss of our culture. But the bottom line is, though, is that you want to be in a culture, but you don't want the actual, you're only in it because you feel that you could make the Prophet your color. If the Prophet was made his real original color, many of these Asians and many of these people who claim they're Muslim wouldn't be in it. That's why they have to make him their color and talk about, oh, the color's not important, which is not saying it isn't important, or it's overly important. But the reason why they do this a lot is so they can sneak in their gutter practices.
That's interesting. Interesting you should say that the color's not important, but I'm going to insist on changing him to fit my ethnocentric narrative. And then after I've done that and I feel comfortable where he's been designated, then I tell you that the color isn't important.
This is a bit like what
the Europeans do Christians do with Jesus. They made Jesus, Prophet Isa alayhi salam, a white man, a blonde Nordic white man in imagery. And after they've solidified that, then they'll tell you, actually, this arguing about what his complexion was is very, very not really important. Forget what it says in the book of Revelation, his skin like burnt brass, burnt in an oven, and woolly hair and fiery eyes and stuff like that. Let's just all get along. I mean, what's color got to do with it?
Yeah, but yet they practice it daily. And I must make this point clear as well. In a Nietzschean, Kantian way, or an Aristotelian way, it's this kind of cognitive dissonance that these people espouse. So don't like black men or black people marrying into their family, but then they'll put Bilal again on his high pedestal. If he was walked into their very house, if he came and walked into their very living room and goes, I'd like to marry your daughter that wants to marry me, they'll be outraged because it's a fantasy. So it's a similar schizophrenic concept of the American white people. They will praise Kobe Bryant when he slam dunks. They will love Kobe Bryant. They will love Jimi Hendrix. So Jimi Hendrix could leave a concert where he's been completely adored, walk out, cross the road, jaywalk, and then he would get slammed to the floor and choked.
It's a splitting of the power of attraction and repulsion, as Imam Ali alayhi salam is talking about.
You can see all over the world, black Muslims, black people, black Christians, because in all these religions, we're at the bottom of the level of the rung. Whether you want to go to in the Catholic Church, we're at the bottom. Jehovah's Witnesses, we're at the bottom. In Islam, we're at the bottom. You go to Saudi Arabia, you see black people at the bottom. So the dynamic is white at the top, black at the bottom. And enough is enough, because that which is at the bottom controls that which is at the top. And we're going to shake it and shake it until the top falls. Because if we can't have our share in the house, we're going to burn it down. And that's what's happening in America. They don't own anything over there. That's a plantation. And that's why the slaves are burning the plantation down. So people are saying, burning your own property, blah, 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 blah. If you live in a shack all your life with rats and water and rain coming through, and you burn it, your master gets upset because you burn your own shack. Because you don't own any of that stuff. And the Muslims better watch England as well, because we've had enough of being second-class citizens and segregated in the mosque. We're not coming after your woman. We don't want your woman. We don't want to. We not to want to be around you. But when we come to the masjid, we don't want you coming up to us and saying to us, brother, when you become Muslim, when you are revert, brother. I've had my brother-in-law from Senegal being stopped in the masjid and asked foolish things like, when did you convert to Islam? This man being Muslim in his tribe for thousands of years. Well, these Asians who was running to the Ganges with their bottom showing and worshipping Ganesh and a half-headed elephant god and a monkey and a rat, going to be telling him and asking him, how long has he been Muslim?
Wow, wow. It's that, bro, it's that deep. It's that deep. But, you know, we're coming up to the end of this segment, yeah? And I want to say something. I mean, Aristotle had a saying where he said, those who know do, and those that understand teach.
Alhamdulillah.
You know? And it's time now to not just know, but to actually teach. It's time now to speak. It's the time now to stand up and be accounted for. And like I said, we've been pushing this dialogue for a period of time, and it's very refreshing. It's very refreshing to see in other quarters of the Muslim community, some black people showing some steel, some backbone, some resilience, to name it. And it just touches my heart. But we want to kind of finish out, so bro, I want to leave you with the microphone to make the last powerful closing out before we shut this section down.
SubhanAllah. Well, all I can say is that if your family, your friends, your relatives have any negative attitudes anymore, ever show any negative attitude towards black people, we're asking you non-black Muslims to challenge them. Don't feel awkward. Don't feel embarrassed. Don't feel ashamed, right? Don't let them reference Bilal when you know it's what they're saying is virulent racism, right? Challenge them. It starts in the homes, and it will start in your communities, and it will start, we need to start a conversation that even dismantles your level of prejudice against light-skinned, dark-skinned Asians and Iranians and Arabs.
Wicked. That's nice, man. All praise is due to Allah. Until next time, as we started in peace, we end in peace. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam for me, son of Malcolm. And may you all walk in peace and be blessed with peace. Assalamu alaikum. Peace out.